A warm welcome to all my students. In social science in previous class, we were discussing about culture. As a continuation of this lesson, let us discuss today. In previous class, we learned meaning and nature of culture, origin of culture, definitions of culture, types of culture and features of culture. I hope you would have understood the concept of these points, whichever we have discussed. If you have any doubt, you can clarify with me. You can contact me personally in my personal number and you can clarify your doubt. Today, let us continue the same chapter. In today's class, we'll be learning about the importance of culture, relationship between culture and society, importance and significance of cultural rituals and diversity. Under importance of culture, we are going to discuss about 4 points. First point is, culture is a treasure of knowledge. Second, culture explains situations. Third, culture defines values. Fourth, culture explains behavioral models. And the importance of culture, the first point is, culture is a treasure of knowledge. Why are we calling the culture as the treasure of knowledge? It provides the knowledge which are needed for the social and physical existence of the human beings. If you see, the animals can survive and get adjusted with their natural environment with the help of their instincts. But human beings use their knowledge in order to survive. And if you see, the language is a part of culture. And the future generation is guided by the present generation using the language as a tool. And the culture tells us how different humans ought to live more than animals and birds. While comparing animals and birds, how the humans are different, the culture tells us. And it teaches a way of life changing and it provides complementary knowledge for social development and it guides the next generation. And basically, it provides necessary knowledge for human beings for their social and physical existence. Hence, culture is not only the bundle of traditions, it is a treasure of knowledge which is indeed for the social development. Hope you'd have understood this point. Now let's move on to the second point. Culture explains situations. If you see, the culture defines the social situations for the human beings. And not only it defines, but also the conditions and determines what we eat and drink, what we wear, when to laugh, weep, sleep, love, to make friends with, and what work we have to do, and which God or what God we have to worship, what knowledge we rely upon, what poetry we recite, and so on. So many things it defines and explains about that. And it explains about the situations of a particular period of time. And the studies of culture reveals the evolution of human society with relation to contemporary situations. And if you see the caves and architecture of the temples in and around Aihole and Badami of Bagalkote reveals the progress of the human society of that particular period. So, did you understand, children? The culture explains the situation of a particular period of time. and it introduces social systems of different situations and also determines how to live in a physical situation and how the human beings can adapt to the lifestyle of Himalayan mountain or in the desert or else even in the forest. So in general, we can say that it gives us the directions. Culture gives us the directions, or it directs us to live peacefully in different situations. Next is the third point. Culture defines values. Values are the tool that analyzes the attitudes, behavior, and thoughts of a particular society. So culture reveals human relations and it teaches us love, honor, trust, and faith. And it teaches the values to the community. Compliance is compulsory for everyone. All the citizens of our country of multiculturalism feel that we are all the same as the constitution, according to the constitution intends. So if you see the value, value is a tool which analyzes the attitudes, behavior, and thoughts of a particular society. So the value advocated by our constitution seeks equality between the people. So people are expected to live without any discrimination, which are based on caste, creed, or even language. So this value orientation creates a thought process among the people. And this thought process builds a set of attitudes among the human beings. So we are calling culture has the capacity to strengthen the human relationship. So did you understand, children? So culture helps us to define the values. Next, the last one, the culture explains behavioral models. So culture is explaining is about the behavioral models. So it provides the aims and means to achieve human society. The culture provides aims and means to achieve them to human society. It supports the behaviors which are complementary to societal aims. And similarly, it punishes those behaviors which are against the societal aims. So culture explains the rules and regulations of the society, societal norms. If a behavior is against of the social aims, it punishes. At the same time, it rewards the good behaviors. For example, the corrections which are done by the teachers and the elders whenever there are undesirable behavior among the children. Understood? So these are the four points under the importance of culture. So under the importance of culture, we have learned now culture is a treasure of knowledge. Culture explains situations. Culture defines values. Culture explains behavioral models. Now let's move on to relationship between culture and society. Under relationship between culture and society, we'll be learning relationship between culture and society is mutual. And the second point, culture and society are the two phases of the same coins. Now let us discuss about the relationship between culture and society is mutual. If you see, culture is the base of the evolution of human society. Already we have discussed about culture and society. So we have seen society is the platform where the culture is reflected. Culture is the base of the evolution of human society. Culture is a part and parcel of human society. Culture is an indivisible part of the society. The human interaction is based on culture. Without culture, human society is incomplete. So without human interactions, no society can be in existence. Hence, without culture, there is no society, and without society, there is no culture, which are mutually coexisting. Now let's learn about culture and society, or the two faces of the same coin. The social world of humans consists of various societies with numerous human relationships. If you see culture and society here, they are two faces of the same coin. Culture makes human beings different from other animals. Without culture, there is no society. And without society, there is no culture. That we have understood, right? Society is a platform for the culture to get reflected. So culture is reflected in the society's platform. And social controls in a society are based on cultural aspects. The social controls defines the human behavior. Individual in a society, if you see an individual in the society, have memberships in various social institutions. And every institution regulates the behavior of the individual through its cultural tools. So about the social institutions, in the previous lesson, that is in the introduction to sociology, we have learned. You all remember? That is education, school, political institutions, all are coming under the social institution. Even the religion, these are all coming under social institutions. So for example, our interactions with elders are guided by our culture, which are prevalent in our families and society. So how to behave with the elders, how to interact with the elders. We are seeing our family members, elders, and we are following the same thing. And they are guiding us how to interact with elders. Dear children, did you all understand the relationship between culture and society? Now let's move on to importance of cultural rituals and diversity. If we witness every month, every week, one or the other cultural rituals are taking place. Culture strengthens our humanitarian relationship, and it is a cause of good prosperity and affluence of human society. And we can call it as a window for entertainment, is also the window for entertainment and sharing the gesture. Culture removes a personal hatred and jealousy among the people. So if once the cultural rituals, if you see, even in the schools we are celebrating annual day, or as a school day we are celebrating, or Republic Day, Independence Day. So during the time, all are together, everybody are together, we are celebrating that. So by that time, the personal hatred and jealousy had been removed by these cultures. We had removed by following all these celebrations, we are removing the hatred and jealousy. And it is also a window. It is like a window for the entertainment. By means of culture, we are entertaining ourselves. And if you see, and it increases the relationship between the human being, and it strengthens a social relationship. And culture, it is a symbol of skill, and it is a motivational factor for people's lives. For example, fairs, religious rituals, the religious rituals which we are doing in the family, as well as in the temple, or as in the church, mosque. So all these places where the religious rituals are taking place, even in the house we used to do, and even in the wedding celebrations. So these are the examples of where the motivation factor, which is motivating the people's life. So during fairs, that is in the village phase, which are the most important cultural rituals of the rural society of India. A fair is not only a religious expression, and also it functions as a temporary market for the neighboring villages. So in and around the villages, the people of that particular area used to make a temporary market, and they used to sell the product, agricultural produce, or even artifacts. This market is utilized for selling the selling and as well as for buying the domestic animals. And it happens soon after the harvest season. So if you see during Sankranti time, around the villages, if you see, they will be conducting the fairs. And even in the summer season, they used to conduct the fairs. So during this time, what they used to do, they will be conducting many dance programs or cultural programs, all these programs, and which way the people of that part, in and around villages, all the people used to come and celebrate the festival. And in the market, if you see the temporary market, they used to sell the harvest. So whatever they have harvested, maybe the groundnut during the Sankranti time, you can see the groundnut as well as tapioca, all these and sugarcane will be sold on the streets. You can see that. And people participate in the fairs irrespective of their caste. So not only the particular caste used to participate, even all the people. So just want to have a visit of the people. It's just like a get together for the families. Irrespective of their caste, creed and language, they used to participate in the fairs. And fairs reinforce social relationship. Fairs are reinforcing the social bonding between the people. Often fairs have people with different language and culture. They used to display their skills in the form of circus. That also you would have noticed in the village circus, village side fairs. If you have gone, they will be standing and walking on the rope. All these circus they used to show. Similarly, various artisans used to display their skills. So these displays are also the cultural expressions. Many performers, if you see, narrate the local versions of Ramayana and Mahabharata in the temples. If you see outside the temple or is inside the temple, they used to narrate the stories of Ramayana and Mahabharata. So the groups of people who are participating in this phase belong to different language, not only of the particular language, in the vernacular language, even the different language people also used to participate. And even from the different culture groups also, they used to participate in this phase. So they all differ in their physical appearances also, but they assemble in these phase to celebrate. They also appear to be showcasing our, so the same thing, the cultural diversity even reflecting in our constitution. And our constitution aims to achieve the unity in diversity among the people of India. So if you see the fairs in the rural areas, most of the people used to join together by means of devotion or because of religious belief. And there is an entertainment in the fairs. So people used to participate in the fairs irrespective of their caste, creed and language. It is a place where the agriculture produce are sold or bought, and even domestic animals used to be sold in this place and as well as bought. Fairs have people of different languages too. Children, did you hear the word cultural diversity? What do you mean by cultural diversity? Now let's learn the importance of cultural diversity. If you see cultural diversity, which refers to the differences among people because of their racial or ethnic backgrounds, language, dress and traditions. So the people of different language, caste, tradition, clothing or race is called as what? Cultural diversity. So our country is a finest example of cultural diversity. With many languages, religions, music, dance, foods, architecture, which differ from state to state. In India, if you see, each state has their own dance, foods, architecture, even the language, music. It's differ from one state to another in India. The Indian culture is an amalgamation of several cultures. And it is a diverse country where the people used to speak different languages, dress differently, worship different gods, and eating varied food, but essentially everyone is the same. So whether it is a joyous occasion or a moment of grief, people participate wholeheartedly, feeling the happiness or pain. So during the tsunami time, as well as the flood in Kerala and Tamil Nadu, during the pain, how all people used to participate and they were rescuing everyone, you would have seen. And even in the celebration of Independence Day or Republic Day, you can see the people of all religion, language used to participate together. A festival or a celebration is never constrained only to a family in India or only to a home in India. The whole community or neighborhood is involved in bringing the liveliness to an occasion, not only except this time. In all the occasions, they used to participate wholeheartedly. But soon, all of us will be able to celebrate all occasions together. So we usually celebrate all the festivals and celebrations together, irrespective of the religion, language, caste. If you see, the Sankranti would have been celebrated in a Hindu family. But what the Hindu family used to do? They used to distribute the sweets and as well as the preparation, whatever the food they have prepared, to other people. That is maybe the neighbors, whoever maybe the Jains or Christians, they used to share with them. Same way, the Christians and Islamic people also, if you have seen, the Christian friends and Islamic friends, they used to share the food during Christmas. Christians people used to share the food during the Christmas with the Hindu friends, as well as Islamic friends, Jain friends. Jain friends, they won't eat the non-veg, but they used to share the cakes with them. And same way, Islamic people also used to share the food during the Bakrid time. So, Ramzan time. All these are happening. So these are the proof of our cultural diversity. Though we are diverse in culture, in different cultures, we are all united as Indians. And even the Indian Constitution laid the strong foundations for the multicultural democracy by recognizing cultural differences and respecting the diversity. Some of Indians' multicultural accommodation strategies include special cultural and political rights for minorities to live in accordance with their cultural practices and to govern themselves, and setting up institutions to protect and promote their languages and culture. So the Indian Constitution has given a strong foundation for recognizing the multicultural democracy in India. Republic Day celebrations. As I have told you, the Republic Day celebration is one of the diversity. You can see in Republic Day celebration, all the different sort of people, different dances and performances and skills will be exhibited during Republic Day celebrations, that you would have noticed during the time of Republic Days. If not so, you can witness that on January 26th of this academic year via TV. So the Republic Day celebrations, the entire nation's cultural diversity is showcased. Tableaus depicting various cultural aspects of India get displayed at our capital city. In the Delhi, all the tableaus of various cultural aspects used to be displayed. A tableau displaying the rural life of northern Karnataka is displayed, along with another tableau displaying the rural Rajasthan. So each state, their ethnic dancers or ethnic group of people used to come and display their tableaus. Every year, the Republic Day celebrations showcase our unity in diversity. And if you see the language, there is a multi-language culture in our country. People living in India belongs to different languages. The person who lives in different linguistic areas understands the culture and practice of that particular region. So language is another example of the cultural expression. Children growing up in a social environment that has multi languages learn more than 2-3 languages. Even in our school, you can see most of the Kannadigas can understand the Tamil and other languages, Tamil as well as Telugu language. So the neighboring languages, they are able to, because the people, more of them are speaking different languages, right? So the people, the children who are growing in such social environment, they are capable of speaking many languages. If you see the Bangaloreans, they are able to speak more than four languages, as three languages as they are studying in schools, that is English, Kannada and Hindi. Three languages they are studying in school. Apart from that, they are learning Telugu. They are able to speak Telugu and even Tamil. Even the Auto people, if you see, they are able to speak five languages, because they are grown up. They have grown up in that social environment where there are more languages, where there is a multi-language culture. This learning not only involves that language, not only the languages known for them, but even includes the culture of that language. Thus, they go beyond the narrow jacket of religion or caste. Beyond their religion, beyond their caste, they are able to think and they are able to have a broad sense, broad mind. Another simple example, if you see, the various laborers working together in a factory setup. So children growing in this multicultural social setup learn to mark festivals and other rituals of the social groups present there. So if you see in schools, we have multi-language group of students, and even in this locality, if you see, there are people who are speaking the different languages, not only one language, not only Kannada, not only Telugu, not only Tamil. So most of the languages are spoken in our area. So obviously, children are able to understand their culture as well as the festivals of that particular language. So this helps in respecting the cultural diversity. This helps the students and the children to respect the cultural diversity. So India is a country of diversity in culture. Everyone appreciates this cultural diversity. It is our country that loves plurality. It is a supplement, inspirational and helpful to the development of human society. This can make peace in the human race, and the respect for cultural diversity fosters peace and development in human societies. Children, in today's class, we have learnt about the importance of culture and the relationship between culture and society. The last one, the importance and significance of cultural rituals and diversity. Now, let's move on to the home assignment. Children, I have given you only two questions. First question is, what do you mean by cultural diversity? About cultural diversity, I have given in this video itself. And the second question is, India is a land of cultural diversity. Explain with examples. Children, the second question is, India is a land of cultural diversity. Explain with examples. So this answer, second one, you have to think, analyze and write with some examples. If you are going through this video, you can come across why we are calling our country as a land of cultural diversity. You can understand. Whatever you understood, you can frame your sentences and can write. Minimum, I expect 6 or 7 sentences to be written in your home assignment. Children, next week you have the submission of classwork and homework. So by Tuesday onwards, you may not be getting the classes, but make sure you have to complete all your homework assignment as well as workbook assignments. And maybe in this month, in the third week or else in the last week of Jan, we'll be having the exam. That is, the assessment will be conducted. Formative assessment will be conducted in this month itself. So make sure you have to be thorough with all the lessons, and even the submission of home assignment as well as workbook assignment, you have to concentrate on. And those who have not completed, complete it soon. Now let's move on to workbook assignment. In page number 99, first main fill in the blanks, question number 4 and 5 you have to write. And page number 101, third main answer in 4 or 5 sentences. Question number 4 and 5 you have to write in page number 1 or 2. First main, choose the best answer. Question number 3. In page number 102 and 103, second main, answer the following briefly. Question number 1 and 2 you have to write. Refer your answer key and write. And if you are capable to write your answers on your own, you can write. But make sure the sentence has to be proper and the important points has to be covered in it. Okay, children. Thank you. We'll see you in the next class.